And welcome to Sociology 315, the Sociology of Work. This class is part of the Implied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This spring, we are broadcasting through four classes: Management 312, Organizational Behavior, on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m., Sociology 315, this class, the Sociology of Work, on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m. Marketing 350, Principles of Marketing, on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And Communications 300, Organizational Communications, on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you completed the first 2 years of college, you could earn your degree by enrolling in any of these classes. All of the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years and then started over. If you would like more information on the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or give us a call at 1-866-278-6789. Welcome, everybody. This is our second class of the Sociology of Work, and we're going to get right into it, talk a little bit about the class. I still haven't posted our topic outline yet because I'm still trying to secure some guests, but as soon as I do, I will have that posted, and I'll keep you current through the TV, so once you tune in to the class, you'll know which chapter goes along with that class. So for the first lecture, we were talking about chapters 1 and 2, and then we're talking about chapter 3. Chapter 3, and then chapter 13. So if you kind of keep going on those 1, 2, 3, and 13, you'll be caught up on what we're doing. Today, we're going to talk about globalization. And we're going to talk about what it is, what are the consequences, are there any benefits to globalization? We always hear negative stuff, but are there any benefits to this idea of a global world, a global economy? What are your rights in a globalized economic system? And is it good or bad? Is it something that we should be fighting for, or is it something that we should be fighting against, or is it a little combination of both? And so I want to start off with our first clip, because when we think about globalization, we often think about something that has recently happened, and that's the spread of the H1N1 virus, and this idea of swine flu becoming a global pandemic. So let's take a look at a news clip of when this came about and try to remember what it was like when we first started to hear about swine flu. So let's take a look at our first clip.
Swine flu breeds in pigs, spreads from person to person.
This new kind of swine flu.
This terrifies me. In fact, the New York City students may have been exposed to this.
The Department of Health and Human Services will declare today a public health emergency.
We are sort of at ground zero if you don't need it. This is a hospital where they're taking care of. Those were the early cases of swine flu.
Swine flu has crossed the Atlantic with cases confirmed in the UK and Spain.
The World Health Organization says the world is now closer to an influenza pandemic than at any time in the last 40 years.
There's solid evidence of person-to-person contact. Now, this is called a swine flu, but there's genetic evidence also of human and bird components to it, and it's exactly that kind of virus that officials have been worried about setting off a possible pandemic.
Good morning to you both.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thanks for listening. You know, I'm thinking of raw pigs and I brought back from Mexico. I think after a while, in fact, swine flu has America on edge on a lot of different levels. There's no folks have absolutely no reason to be too upset. Looks like our government stands pretty upset and concerned about it.
Okay, so think about all those clips. And the last question says, well, what is the real story? Regardless of how you want to look at it, the real story is that we no longer live in isolated little communities. So what happens in one part of the world, like something like a illness outbreak, actually has long-term impacts and has fingers that spread out to all different parts of the world. So when we think about globalization, this is the first thing that we think of. And we imagine that, you know, you can see this disease traveling from one place to the next place to the next place, and all of a sudden we have, quote-unquote, a global pandemic, which means that from the littlest hut in Zimbabwe to the White House, this issue is important to them. And so when we talk about a global reality, this is a relatively new reality. This is a completely, in a way, new world. It didn't just start, but we're well into it right now. And so what is globalization? Globalization is the process where goods, information, people, money, communications, fashions, all different forms of culture, and all different forms of social artifacts move across national boundaries. And so we can be talking about food, we can talk about ideology, we can talk about illness, we can talk about images of beauty. Why is everybody around the world now dyeing their hair blonde or perming their hair? It's because the images of beauty are coming from different parts of the world into other countries. And so globalization, though, also involves economic systems as well as social systems. So today we're going to talk about one of the economic systems. And the first thing that's it's important to remember is that globalization is a process, not a thing. It is not something that you wake up the next day and we're globalized. It's continuing. It's going on right now. It has different manifestations. It's working on different levels in our lives. It involves the economic system, the social and cultural relationships. It involves cultural expressions. I was watching the National Geographic channel, and there was this channel of a community that was very, very historically polygamous. They had multiple partners. They had many husbands, many wives, all of that. And now their culture is beginning to change because they've had contact with Western ideas of marriage and monogamy, so now that's being infused into their culture. And so it's cultural expression as well as everything else. It also involves political policies. At one point, our political policies revolved around individual communities doing what individual communities needed to survive. We live in a world where our scope is a little bit bigger than that. The process of globalization is not uniform. It's not, and not everyone experiences it the same way. And that's one of the first things we're going to explore today. Where it's positive for some, it has very negative consequences for others. And I have a clip art that has a globe in the middle that says globalization, and I want to see if they can put that up. And that's one of them, and that kind of shows the different realms of globalization. So I don't want you to only think economy when you're thinking globalization. Just as an aside, think about this. The media, not only were we able to see those little clips from CNN and Fox and all of that, but people all over the globe saw those news stories. So they got the same news as us. When you talk about the society in general, you can go to almost any place and find a McDonald's. And the McDonald's in general have the same food and, you know, the same ideas and images and all of that. So this is really important to understand the kind of multi-layered entity we're talking about when we talk about globalization. And I want to remind you that I still have a cold. I'm on the Alka-Seltzer and all of that, so I still may be a little bit congested. And this is one of the clips that's very interesting because it includes almost every aspect of your life, the social world, free trade, terrorism, all of these things, your food, are now linked in some way globally to the rest of the world. And so from Disney to Barbie to hip-hop to McDonald's, we have exported all of these things. And in the last 20 years, what we've seen in economics is that communications have even changed. So this image here of this little spider of globalization also involves how we talk to each other. Think about how quickly we got the information on Haiti, and we got the information on all of the things that went on in different parts of the globe. All right, many writers ask whether this is unstoppable. And I will not be able to answer that question today. I can't predict the future, but it's something you have to ask yourself. And in the work of called No Nonsense Globalization, Wayne Elwood says that globalization could lead to a good world. If we did certain things certain ways, we could have food for everyone. We could have a globe that considered everyone's human rights. But he says right now we're overshadowed by greed, we're overshadowed by individualism and profit. And he says that what is really happening now are gaps between the rich and poor, and these gaps are widening, so you have people who have more money than their ancestors will be able to spend in a lifetime. And then you have people who have nothing, not even in comparison, they just have nothing. You have local cultures that are losing ground, because as the world becomes global, people from outside are coming into those communities and making decisions for those communities. Elwood says you have a lot of biological diversity being destroyed because we're not monitoring how we're growing across the globe. We're just growing. Then we also have regional tensions increasing. And this is because we have defined resources as scarce, and we have limited resources on the planet. And so how do we all use all the oil that we want and live in the warmth and comfort of a modern society? If I get it, maybe people in China will not be able to get it. And so one of the things that Elwood says is that the economic and the environmental system might be heading for a collapse because of how we are developing, how globalization is growing. And I want to go to the next clip because what comes up when we think of globalization is also how it impacts other cultures. So let's take a look at how it impacts others across different parts of the world. So let's look at new rulers of the world.
In recent months, 10 people, most of them young, have protested against the new economic order called globalization. This represents one of the greatest popular movements since the 1960s. Surely never before has the human race enjoyed such amazing capacity to create wealth and reduce poverty. Yet never before has the gulf between rich and poor been so fast and inequality so widespread. The facts of globalization are revealing. A small group of powerful individuals are now richer than most of the population of Africa. Just 200 giant corporations dominate a quarter of the world's economic activity. General Motors is now bigger than Denmark. Ford is bigger than South Africa. Unseen by shoppers in the high street, the famous brands of almost everything from running shoes to baby clothes are now made in very poor countries with cheap labor, at times bordering on a form of slave labor. Tiger Woods, the golfer, is paid more money for owning Nike than most of the entire workforce actually making Nike products here in Indonesia. Is this the global village we are told is our future? Or is it merely an old project that used to be run by the divine right of kings and is now run by the divine right of multinational corporations and by the financial institutions and governments that back them? This film is about these new rulers of the world and especially their impact on the modern country, Indonesia. Indonesia is where the old imperialism meets the new. This is a country that should not be poor. This which should always ever be. Mountains of copper and gold, oil, timber, and the skills and labor of its people. Colonized by the Dutch in the 16th century, Indonesia is plundered by the West for hundreds of years, a debt that has yet to be paid back. Dynamic success you don't see. This is a living man that's home to workers who hate the clothes we buy in the high streets and shopping malls. This is the human price paid for our fashionable trainers and smart shirts and jeans with a tag that says, Made in Indonesia. The young people living here who make the famous brands are paid on average the equivalent of 72 pence a day without a dollar. There's no legal minimum wage in Indonesia. According to the Indonesian government, it's just over half the living wage. The forges are made from breeze blocks and packing cases. When it rains, they flood. There are open sewers and no clean running water. Many of the children are undernourished and prey to disease. While I was schooling here, I caught dengue fever, carried by the mosquitoes which infest these slums. It kills children. The conditions here are not very different from workers' camps in other parts of Asia, in Africa and Latin America, where the famous brands are also made cheaply for lovely Western workers.
Okay, sorry you caught me taking out my cough drop. Alright, when you think about what's going on in Indonesia, the workers that are making those products are doing it for about a dollar a day, which is half, a little bit more than half, of what you actually need for a livable wage in that country. And so what we see in where, you know, where Wayne Edwood is kind of leading us to look is at how these disparities are being manifest in our society. Think about a situation where for that wedding that we saw in Indonesia, the cake alone cost more than the average salaries of probably all of those people serving that event. And it would take 400 years for an employee who is serving that event to be able to afford that event. That's a tremendous economic disparity that we're setting up in our society. And so when you think about this idea of Indonesia and globalization, this is new globalization in terms of what's going on with Indonesia. But one of the older gentlemen in that video mentioned that this place has been exploited for years by other people. So let's talk a little bit about when globalization started, because this is not new. This idea that goods and services and trade travel across national boundaries is not new. Thomas Friedman talks about globalization 1.0, globalization 2.0, and globalization 3.0. And he says these are three different periods of global development. And they kind of all flow into each other, and in reality, all build upon what went on in the previous era. And so this idea of global movement has actually been going on for hundreds of years. And so when we think about small countries like Indonesia, these countries were colonists. And I mean, yes, colonists of larger countries. And so these countries have always, well, not always, but at that time had this movement of resources around. So Friedman says globalization 1.0 started with the European explorers in about the 1400s. So from about the 1400s to the 1800s, we have this globalization 1.0. And think about Columbus's voyages of discovery. He left Europe, he traveled all to this country, discovered all these great things. However, Columbus started the Atlantic slave trade, because what he did when he left was took natives back with him as slaves and displays. And so this set the trade route from the United States and Spain and Portugal and all of that. With this quest for subjects that Britain had and all of these strong countries at the time, they were looking for converts, they were looking for gold, they were looking for ways to get wealth from other places. Well, that's exactly what's going on in our current idea of globalization. This colonial period lasted for about 450 years. We know of trade in fruits. Think about the cotton trade. That was a global trade. Cotton left, went north, went to all parts of Europe from places in the south. People began to travel all over the earth. And this kind of laid the foundation for what we have today. And one quote from someone living in 1890, Cecil Rhodes, and he's the original founder of Rhodesia, that later became Zimbabwe. He was a businessman. He was a spokesman. And in 1890, this is what he said regarding expansion. He said, "We must find new lands from which we can easily obtain raw materials and at the same time exploit cheap slave labor that is available from natives of the colonies." Also said that the colonies would serve as dumping grounds for surplus goods from British factories. So this is exactly what we have today when we see people traveling to other lands. They're looking for cheap labor, maybe a little slave labor. We'll talk about that in a little while. But they're also looking for places to get resources and places to dump products. And so this has been going on ever since we started actually moving across the globe. So this is globalization 1.0. Globalization 2.0 kind of begins with the 1800s and moves into our modern era. And this was the institutionalization of this global movement and this global economic movement as well. The British, the French, the Dutch, the Portuguese, the Belgians, the Americans, they carved up the world. And not only did they carve up the world in terms of land, but they carved up the world in terms of resources and rights to those resources. And that was how we kind of lived in the society for a while. Up until the early 1900s, countries had sole rule over their own economic systems. So countries set prices, countries restricted labor as they saw fit. Businesses, in essence, were tied to national boundaries. And during this time, we have this idea of what is good for Ford is good for America, you know, that kind of idea. And imagine with the Industrial Revolution, not only could you extract more, you could create more, you could produce more, and you could export more. So let's take a look at our next clip on the Industrial Revolution. All right, we're going to come back to that clip. I actually skipped and I switched the clip up. So what I'd like to do now is look at the Industrial Revolution. And that's a clip from YouTube. So when it's ready, they'll let me know. But think about what was going on in industrialization. Industrialization was this process where we were moving from agriculture, small economies, to large global economies. And when we think about the Industrial Revolution, it's really important to think about how that impacted work. What did we do before the Industrial Revolution? All right, they're telling me the video is ready, so let's take a look at the Industrial Revolution. They have the clip following that we're on the now. So let's take a look at the Industrial Revolution.
What does it take to move a mountain? During the Industrial Revolution, technological and socio-economic advances were not only moved, but transformed, and the sweeping changes initiated. The actually affected countries all over the world. In the 18th century, domestic yeast even began the availability of critical modern commerces as a thing that set the stage for change. Ingenuity turns many yields from specimens to follow its views into a time and time saving device. We must all be for textile and gold factories essentially replace hand spinning and weaving. With the textile industry leading the way, the shift to manufacturing created unprecedented demand for new machines, mechanical components, process materials, and skilled labor. Transportation systems expanded to keep up with the escalating flow of goods. Cities grew, work became increasingly specialized and mechanized and urbanized. An agricultural-based economy evolved into an industrial one. The marriage of science and industry produced great changes both at home and abroad. Elon Newby's comment in 1763. Charles Babbage's mechanical computer, 1834. The first steam carriage, steamship, and steam locomotive. All these inventions emerged within a very fertile 80-year span. And even today, many of the world's mountains are still being used as the products and processes born of the Industrial Revolution continue to shape and transform our whole lives.
Okay, so think about this. How this transformed our lives. What were people doing before this movement to cities? They were farmers, they were merchants, small merchants, very, very specialized. And now we have this movement into factories, into industry. A much greater interface between man and machines or technology. And so this Industrial Revolution also signaled this global movement of resources around the world. Think about all of the textiles that you could get all the way from, I don't know, the Mississippi Delta to Asia, or the fruits and produce you could get from the African coast over to New York City. And so this was the Globalization 2.0 period. We were moving, we were shaking, and the jobs were very much tied to the development of the society as a whole. Because as the employment sector industrialized, think of what that meant for the society. We started having automobiles, we started having much more technology, we started having freezers and washing machines and later TVs and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And this began to change the nature of our work in society. And where something happened in the late 1900s, 1800s, and we're going to talk about that in a minute, but let's talk about Globalization 3.0. Because according to Friedman, this is where we are right now. And this kind of started in the middle of the 1900s and really, really got going good in 2000, and now we're well into this. And this is the technological global period. It's the period of the national corporations, international trade, world trade treaties. And so now we've kind of come full circle in a way. All of the countries are still interacting with each other. And some may say it's exactly the same. Big countries are still exploiting little countries. But now we have this idea of corporate involvement at a national level. And so we have to talk about that. And when you think about it, what does this mean for us? What does Globalization 3.0 look like for Americans? And now let's go to that clip, Where Are the Jobs?
Job creation, and the quantities
Alright, so what it looks like for us, and I think this is an interesting video because it's a Ron Paul video, and it actually kind of has some really good comments, but it asks good questions. What does the speed that we, in this global economy, starting in 2000, started exporting American jobs, started exporting the technology, started exporting the factories? How did that impact these workers now? And we now know that video was from the early 2000s. Look at where we are now in 2010. We're in, quote unquote, one of the worst economic crises the world has ever seen. And so you can see this progression of where we were to where we're going. So when you think about these three periods of globalization, the early one, traveling across the globe, and I want you to think back on this because the idea of globalization as we know it now involves the entire world. But when you think about the Greeks, the Huns, the Romans, the Aztecs, when they conquered their area and all the surrounding communities, for them, that was the known world. But now what we're talking about is the entire globe when we talk about the known world. And so this is very, very interesting. I have a question that says, do you think this kind of behavior, greed and exploitation, is simply an expansion of the same kind of behavior that naughty children exhibit when they refuse to share their toys? I think it is, because in a way that's actually part of capitalism, me, 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 my mind. If I don't have all my toys, I'm going to take everything and go home. And so that's a funny question, but it actually, it could be looked at that way. And we see that when corporations, which is going to be our next week's topic, often don't get their way in certain communities. So this idea of globalization, think about the process, and then when you get to where we are, think about now where we're going. One of the things Eclipse said is that there is job growth. But the Economic Policy Institute talks about that job growth is coming in temporary or part-time jobs. So what does that mean for your health insurance and all of your other benefits as a worker? And these are the questions we need to ask when we start talking about globalization. All right, I want to go to a break. And when I come back, we're going to kind of quickly go through the history to get us where we are, starting from slavery, and then talk a little bit about what we have going on right now. So let's take a break, and then we will be right back.
You are watching the streaming television program service on California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Projects primarily in the states of Maine. It's a dream, it's a vision that there will be at least
first interview. My name is Kat Zimmich. I'll be the director of the Art Gallery, and we'd like to welcome you to our upcoming exhibit CES. Coming up from November 12th through December 10th of 2009 is Beauty Dimensions, T.U. Ashcraft, New Rosemary Building. It's an exhibition featuring 35 works of art by two contemporary artists from Los Angeles who work with figure in two and three dimensions. On display will be artists T.U. Ashcraft's large-scale mixed-media drawings of nudes and Russell Mullen's fantastic ceramic figures, including Dara, Culture, and Icon. His torsos are covered in armor and those two corsets and made of ceramic and mixed-media. Thank you so much, and we look forward to seeing you at our exhibition CES Stereo.
Thank you.
attention businesses in the South Bay of Los Angeles, the South Bay Resource Network, and the South Bay One Stop Shop here to any day grow.
I found out about the one South Bay representative in my store representing the services that we provide.
This is we've opened over 4,000 applicants. That is 5,000 in one stop meeting helped us find issues with alcohol disease.
My business is signed. One stop provides knowledge training that provides a resource for contacts, also provides a resource for training to do things. Take some of the infection training pieces. Classes and areas of the
day. It was just a great experience. The members of the non-stop were always helpful in understanding
resources in the state of the TCC. The South Bay Resource Network is here for you. Call 313-977-7799 or visit our website at southbayresource.net. The non-stop is your resource for business in South Bay.
This is my heresy.
Welcome back. I'm Dr. Spars, and welcome to Sociology 315, the Sociology Report. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This spring, we'll be broadcasting four classes, Management 312, Organizational Behavior, on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m., Sociology 315, the Sociology of Work, on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m., Marketing 350, the Principles of Marketing, on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m., and Communications 300, Organizational Communications, on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you could earn your degree by enrolling in these classes. All of the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years and then repeated. If you would like more information on the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or give us a call at 1-866-278-6789. All right, welcome back. We're in the middle of our discussion of globalization, and we talked about the difference between globalization 1.0, 2.0, 3.0. And 3.0 is where we are right now. So let's just do a real quick fast forward through kind of U.S. labor history in about 2 seconds down and dirty. Of course, this country was founded from the roots of the European feudal system. And so when we think about, you know, the organization of the early settlers here, there was craftsmen and guilds and all of that kind of stuff. We moved that model from that feudal system and think about what work was then. Work was done by pretty much everybody in the family, men, women, children, everything. And work was for the survival of the immediate family. Work was for the exchange of immediate resources. And when you think back on the feudal system, work in essence was for the good of the king, the good of the kingdom. And so this was our roots. As we moved through our history, we went into a period for some in the society, as some industrialized, we had slavery as work. And think about what slavery is. Slavery is labor without compensation. And when you think about slavery, slavery was not invented with the European colonists. Slavery is part of the human condition. Many cultures had slaves because think about slavery. Many cultures wanted people to do the hard, the dirty, the backbreaking work without compensation. So if you take all the emotion out of slavery and all of that kind of stuff, what you see is slavery is a system of labor. And it's an actually very, very effective system of labor. Not only was Washington, D.C. built with slave labor, but so was parts of Egypt, parts of Asia, parts of the Aztec Empire, basically parts of many cultures all over the world. But in the U.S. here, we had African chattel slave labor. And that kind of looked a little different. We're not going to go off into too much of that. But it was getting one group and identifying one group with that form of labor in essence forever. So what the U.S. slave system said was all Africans are determined to be slaves. And this was actually passed as Virginia Law, Virginia Policy. And think about slavery wasn't supposed to end. So this was supposed to be how our country, how our culture was run. We had one group who would do the hard, the back-breaking labor. Then we had another group who would do other labor, light labor, hard labor, but for a wage and not for free. And so slavery, and some say, is actually a really good way to get things done, because many of the things you need to do in the society, people won't volunteer for. Who's going to volunteer to pull huge blocks of pyramid up 7 million feet in a ramp or whatever? Who's going to volunteer to chisel granite that was used in building the Washington Monument? And so slavery was an actually very effective form of acquiring labor in this country. Then we move, like I said, to the Industrial Revolution. And now here we have, there's a small period in our history where we have this focus on some groups doing free labor as the society industrializes. And so here you have for Africans, labor was free. Labor was uncompensated. For other Europeans coming in, for people coming in through Ellis Island, labor was compensated, but it was done so depending on your status, maybe depending on your ethnic group. So if you were Irish and you worked at some jobs, you were often paid less. And so when we think about it, we had a lot going on at one point in U.S. history. Then we move to this Industrial Revolution, like I said, and this is about the trade of goods and services all over the globe. So now we are able to move resources much more efficiently than we did in the past. With the development of industrial-sized ships, with the development of that kind of technology. And so now we're here where we are. We are in the information age, and this is the digital media revolution. We have instant communication, we have Google, we have virtual reality, and we even have virtual money. And so we are now to the point to where we work not necessarily for the immediate exchange of resources, so we don't work and get bread in exchange. We all now work for money. And in the future, we all may work for credit. And so once you complete your work, whatever your labor is, you may get 50 credits put on your personal account. So you may actually even move away from money in our modern generation. So, is this good for us or is this not good for us? There are two views of globalization. Anthony Giddens talks about the radicals versus the skeptics. And these two views see globalization as having two completely polarized realities. The radicals see globalization changing everything. They're saying that the marketplace is now indifferent to national boundaries. And so we have people like Walmart that has no country loyalty. Walmart is loyal to Walmart. Walmart is not loyal to America. And so this is really important when you start talking about how money is coming in and out of corporations. And so the radicals are saying, look, with this new reality and the companies playing on this global marketplace, nations have lost their sovereignty. We are no longer setting our own policies, but the policies are being increasingly set by global demands, global corporations, and global markets. The radicals also say that finance and capital is flowing now across borders, and to where one corporation was kind of rooted, for example, the car industry was rooted in Detroit. That money that came into the car industry stayed in that area, stayed in that region. Now, the car industries are rooted somewhere else, or the business may be in Detroit, but the corporation may be in Denmark. And so the money actually is not being recycled into that community. The radicals also say that electronic money, this idea of transfer of debit, it's amazing to me that, you know, all the transactions you can do without actually touching cash. I thought it was the best thing in the whole world when I could get online and transfer money between my accounts just virtually. You know, and so this is going to change how we have reality. No one carries money anymore. I actually meant to find this commercial. There's a commercial, and it has a really catchy tune to it, and it's the world going around in harmony, and everybody's coming and swiping their little card, and then this one person shows up with either cash or a check, and everything stops moving. Everything slows down. Everything stops. You now have to take this money and count this money. And so this is our reality, and the radicals are saying globalization may destroy us all, especially if it remains unchecked. All right, now the skeptics are saying, look, countries only get a small amount of capital from international trade. So this idea that the international markets are guiding our reality is actually overstated. It's actually a fear tactic. Most trade is still regional, not global at all. For example, Europe largely trades with Europe. And so this idea that we're going to lose ourselves completely to foreign nationals and foreign trade is just simply not kind of panning out when you look at what's going on. And the skeptics also say, this idea that globalization is going to kill us and the needs of regulation is proposed by what's called free marketeers, those who wish to kind of cut back on state expenditures, kind of let things go and let the market go. And you know, so when we see these two sides, we're wondering, now, is this accurate? Are we losing natural borders, natural boundaries, natural control, or is all of this being exaggerated? And for this class, I want you to do a lot of research on the internet once you talk about a topic. So go in and look at the different arguments related to globalization, because the jury is still out. We don't know yet if this is positive and unstoppable, negative and unstoppable, or even unstoppable. And so I want you to go out and kind of read a little bit more about it. The problem with these two views, the radicals versus the skeptics view, is that they tend to only look at globalization in economic terms, and they don't examine other areas that are, quote, being globalized in our society. And just as an aside, I want you to think about something like Tokyo Disney. Not only does Tokyo Disney export American ideals of Disneyland, which is fun and rides and all of that, but it exports a lot more. In these stories of Prince Charming and Sleeping Beauty and Snow White, we're also exporting ideas of gender roles. We're also exporting ideals of beauty. We're also exporting ideals of male roles and female roles. Remember, Disney has a lot of princes riding up on white horses and taking princesses off into a happy castle somewhere. And so when we export Tokyo Disney along with Cinderella and all those other people, we're also giving their kids the introduction to that ideology. We're also saying, you know, hey, Prince Charming will come and ride off and take you, as an idea that we're imparting to girls, or that men are the warriors of Fern Gully or whatever Disney it is. And so when you think about this idea of globalization, on the economic side, it has a devil and an angel. And on the social side, it has a devil and an angel. Because when we are exploiting these social concepts, we have to look at how those are impacting what people are doing all over the rest of the world. In many countries, we now have a job where people dye other people's hair blonde. Before the influx of TV, before the influx of products all over the place, you would have never had that type of employment. So globalization is kind of changing the world in some very funny and interesting ways. All right, I want us to talk a little bit about Keynesian economics. And I am not an economist. And so if anybody can explain it better, call in, because he definitely can do it. But in 1936, John Maynard Keynes argued for he argued that free, unregulated markets actually caused unemployment. And basically what he said, profit in this system required cutting costs, replacing people with technology. And he said, you know, there is a little bit of danger in having just an open, powerful free market system, with no checks, no balances, without boundaries, without regulation. And he said, without this regulation, capitalism will be immobilized by its own greed. And we might be seeing actually a little bit of that right now with the fall of all of these large corporations. And he proposed the notion of the interventionist state and suggested that the government should intervene in some way in the economy. When we were in trouble, when we were experiencing a depression, the government should come in with an infusion of cash and should help to regulate the markets. It is the responsibility of the government to invest in public services, education, job training, healthcare, roads, railways, everything, etc. By stimulating the economy, the government would rekindle demand, and this would create production. Many of you don't know it, but when you were listening to the news when they were telling us last year about the economic crisis, this was one of the arguments you were hearing. Should we step in and bail out the corporate businesses? Should we, the government, should Obama have sent that check to those car industries, to those banks? And this is a question that Keynes would say, we need to do it because this is what is going to help to stabilize our system. And call in and let you know if you agree. And the New Deal policies had this idea in mind. that the government would come in and help shore up the economy of the nation. We wouldn't just leave it to businesses to do on their own. And the American Employment Act of 1946 proclaims the government's responsibility to promote maximum employment, production, and purchasing power. So should we get in and influence jobs? And this was the issue that Obama had to deal with. As soon as he got in, what is the role of government in the economy, and what do you think it is? When you think about this, this is in a way a very idealistic idea, because we assume that the government is going to do a good job of regulating these businesses, and we assume that the government is going to operate in the best interests of everyone involved. So these are the domain assumptions underlying this idea. And this idea comes up all the time. This is the root of the Sunday morning debates that you see going on when you're listening to them argue back and forth. Should we get involved or shouldn't we get involved? And if the government does get involved, to what extent? All right, so let's talk a little bit about how we got up to where we are. And I want to talk a little bit about the Brentwood Trio. And in the 1920s, with the Depression, the U.S. and other countries kind of implemented trade tariffs and barriers and kind of a worldwide economic system. And basically, in 1944, 44 nations got together at the Bretton Woods Conference. And the goal of this conference was to create a framework for the post-World War II economy. And they were trying to set stable international monetary systems and save capitalism. And think about after World War II, we had pretty much kind of blown the world apart in a way. And we were having to figure out how to put things back together. And then we find ourselves dealing also with the legacy of the Depression. And with this, we have this idea of this interventionist state. And we now have to figure out how are we going to negotiate this new world. We are able to wage world war. And think about it, we're also able to have world travel and now world economic trade. So how are we going to regulate this? And one of the things that the Bretton Woods Trio wanted to do at this conference was to establish fixed exchange rates, whereas the states could set their own tariffs, set their own ideas of production value. After the Bretton Woods Trio conference, that was set on a global level. And this was supposed to help regulate the markets and kind of make the cycle function a little differently. They wanted to create a system of free movement of goods and services, and they also established the U.S. dollar as the international currency during this time. And at this time, the dollar was backed by gold, and basically the price was $35 per ounce, and this idea was that the dollar was as good as gold. And so when we think about this, this opened up a new idea of control. The control was no longer going to be with each individual state. It was now going to be at the level of where the nations interacted at the global market. And so I want us to go to our next clip. And then when we come back, we'll continue this discussion.
This is the
Video has a lot for us to deal with because we're going to talk about this dichotomy between having these modern, solar, self-sufficient businesses located in these places of extreme poverty and squalor. But Veronica asked the question, why was it called the Bretton Woods Treaty? And it was called that because it was actually a conference that was in Bretton Woods, New Jersey. And this was where all of these different nations gathered. So I want to talk about that and then get to some of those other points that we saw in the video. The mission of this conference was to create this economic stability for the world, to facilitate expansion and growth and international trade that led to what we saw in the clip, the markets being developed in places like these communities in India. And it wanted to encourage employment and real income growth. So actually growing these countries and developing these countries, the idea was to try to increase trade. One of the things they also did was create fixed exchange rates and stop countries from devaluing their dollars to get their own economic advantage. So everything became kind of uniform. and the goal was to facilitate easier currency conversion. So instead of dealing with rupees and dollars and yens, it was kind of uniform to be able to deal with the movement of the dollar across the borders. And this is why we hear whether the dollar is strong, whether the dollar is weak, it impacts the relationship of the value of the other money. One of the things of the Bretton Woods Treaty was also the International Monetary Fund, and this was supposed to be a lender of last resort for countries who got into trouble. And this was to kind of help them maintain employment, rebuild their infrastructure, and out of this we get the world back. And like I said, this is down and dirty globalization here. But this is supposed to be for restructuring and community development. And they were supposed to provide loans for countries who wanted to increase their economic infrastructure. And what is interesting is as soon as it got started, it became very clear that many countries were not going to be able to pay back these loans. And so in a way, the World Bank almost immediately became, in essence, a loan shark. We're going to give you this money, we're going to tell you how you can use it, and, you know, we're going to keep changing terms, et cetera, and all of that kind of stuff. So we have a lot of countries right now that are in a lot of debt to the World Bank. Their infrastructure has only been slightly developed, and they are now getting deeper and deeper into economic debt. And so this whole idea of the global movement of resources, the global stuff, I see a question here online that says, when will the syllabus be complete for this class? And if you look on the Blackboard announcements page, I put the general information that you need to know for the class. But as I stated earlier, I'm still actually trying to work out the topic schedule. So check out in the book, and it is Jacqueline Wallen, Balancing Work and Family, just in case you didn't see the first lecture. And read up chapters 1, 2, 3, and 13. And so you'll be up to date. And as soon as I can get all my guest speakers, and what I may end up doing in the class is simply listing the topics. And if you guys don't mind, we may take those topics out of order. And one of the reasons we can do that is because instead of giving you one major exam, I'm actually going to give you just short pop quizzes that add up to one exam. So I'm going to ask you pop quizzes related to the different chapters that we go over. In chapter 13, they talk about family benefits in other countries and how the U.S. lags behind in terms of maternity leave and different kind of benefits like that. And then at the very end of the chapter, they talk about the countries that are doing worse with not just a lag behind in benefits, but no benefits. Child labor, sweatshops, exploitation, and all of these things we're going to actually get into a little bit later in the semester. So going on to this idea of what is going on now, and we have, out of this trio, we have the GATT, which is the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, which was developed in 1947, and this was supposed to be this idea between countries that they would keep these regulations, they would keep prices fixed so one country couldn't outprice all of the other countries or have complete control over one market. And this later became, I'm sorry, the World Trade Organization, and later developed out of GATT. And so the WTO developed in 1995, and this was just a continuation of this trade and tariffs agreement. And that clip talks about the critiques, because one of the key things that people are saying about the World Trade Organization is that they are setting trade. They are setting trade policies. They are influencing these policies, and they're using what is good for the business as their standard. without looking at what these trade policies are actually doing for communities. Let me give you an example. In another class, I talk about genetically modified foods and all of the different policies, international and national policies. And some of those critics of the World Trade Organization are saying, you know, you're supporting these food policies, you're supporting genetically modified crops, but you're not asking yourselves, what are these products doing in the long term to the different communities involved? How are they impacting people? And so what the World Trade Center is allowing to occur in terms of trade may not always be in the best interest of the people who are the recipients of that trade. And that's actually what the hoopla is about when you see all of those protests and all of that. And it is kind of interesting because what something happened to this idea of this regulated market, this idea that corporate or nations need to consider each other when planning and when setting their prices. Something kind of went down that helped to unravel all of that and also get rid of this idea that the state should have some kind of hand in the economy. And one of the interesting things, and I'm going to skip ahead a little bit in my notes because I don't want to run out of time, but in the 80s, with the Reagan and the first Bush, we have something going on in our society that actually changes some of the ideas of the Bretton Woods conference. In the 1970s, this old model of the economic structure, which was set up after World War II, it kind of began to collapse. And so let's think about this for a moment. This idea that we can set policy that would regulate the global markets, this idea that the state should be involved. Well, Reagan, Margaret Thatcher, and some of the others in the 80s didn't share this belief system. And their belief system was that an unregulated market, where you actually separated business interests from nation interests, would fare better, would actually provide the influx of capital into the market. This would further open corporate doors, kind of allow businesses to grow and develop. And in the 80s, we got this idea that companies must be free to move anywhere they want. So you didn't have to be tied to Detroit if you were the car industry. You could move your plant over to Indonesia if you wanted. Companies had a right to maximize returns and minimize costs. So if that meant pulling your factory out of that little local Midwest city that it had been in for 50 years, it was okay because the corporations had a right to protect their interests. The city was no longer important. It was what was good for that corporation. And this idea of free trade, unfettered investment, deregulation, low inflation, privatization, all of these ideas kind of blew up a little bit more in the 1980s. And what we see is deregulation of many industries. Mostly what you'll remember is the air traffic control industry. And I always thought, man, for some reason, I think there should be one person responsible for really making sure that that runs properly. I just don't think we need to leave it in individual hands. But that's what happened. This worked well for some, but there were long-term consequences. And this is what we're dealing with right now, the consequences of letting corporations go anywhere, do anything, and get as big as they want. And before we run out of time, because we only have a couple minutes, I want to go to the last clip, because I don't want to leave on a negative about globalization. There is a give and take here. And even though the market is changing, it can actually change in our favor. So let's take a look at the clip on IKEA coming through the United States.
Spread of globalization, our next story exposes a new and fascinating limit on that world economic system. Containers travel by ship, which run on oil, which has shot up in price over the last 2 years. So many international businesses, which long assumed that making their products in one part of the world and shipping them for sale in another was the most efficient method, are now rethinking the whole idea. Our North America business correspondent Greg Wood reports now from Virginia on a community experiencing an unexpected benefit from high transport costs.
In the southern Virginia town of Danville, there's been a foreign invasion. IKEA is making coffee tables and bookshelves here for its U.S. stores. In the past, the Swedish company shipped these items from its factories in Eastern Europe. But since 2000, the cost of moving goods by sea container has tripled because of the high price of oil. IKEA's manufacturing arm, Sweetwood, was part of its first in the States earlier this year to cut down on transportation costs.
This kind of lightweight furniture, which is rather cheap from a cost perspective, the transportation cost is a huge part of that total overall cost. So taking that out, it saves a lot.
The old tobacco warehouses of Danville are being converted to house 21st century businesses, a whole swathe of foreign companies, Polish, Indian, Mexican, are set up plants here to meet near their US customers. Danville city manager says 6,000 new jobs have been created over the past 4 years.
What used to be an affordable situation to ship parts over, put them together overseas and send them back to assemble, doesn't work anymore. You need to manufacture here and deliver here, and because the markets are here.
The wealth of Danville was based on textiles and tobacco. When those industries moved out, thousands of American jobs were exported overseas, and the unemployment rate here became the highest in the state of Virginia. But now, with foreign investors moving in, jobs are being imported again. James Evans lost his old job when the textiles giant Dam River closed its factory here. Now he works for IKEA.
I'm losing my job, and I'm very struggling for 2 years. There were no benefits. The shorts and jobs put in. It's great to have a feeling at comfort at night when you sleep.
The finished coffee tables and bookshelves are loaded onto trucks. Then it's a relatively short journey by road directly to the stores. Danville has benefited from what's known as the neighborhood effect. It's more cost effective now for many international companies to make things as close as possible to their consumers. Some experts argue that expensive oil will bring a halt to the globalization of business. Professor Jeffrey Sachs from the Earth Institute at Columbia University in New York says that's unlikely.
I don't see a surge in employment, for example, coming back to the manufacturing sector in the U.S., meaning that it becomes the bulk of the employment sector. That's what some people may be looking for or expecting when they hear that globalization will be impeded by rising energy prices. I would say don't hold your breath for that.
In New York, a free water taxi ferries customers to IKEA's new megastore in Brooklyn. So the Swedish company is not only changing the way it transports its goods, it's changing the way it transports its customers too.
Okay, as we're running out of time, think about it. Is there going to be this kind of global backlash? Because as we become more global, as we have more of a demand on resources, the oil prices are going to continue to go up as well, because the oil is going down. So Will we see this? What side do you land on? Do you think there's a possibility that these companies that went offshore to have the products made and then ship them back here may have to actually come back, or those international companies may end up coming over here? And so we're almost out of time. And this topic of globalization is vast. You can have an entire course on this one particular topic. But I want you to remember from today that this process didn't just begin. It just looks differently over the course of time. And when we start talking about the rest of the class, we're going to come down to how does that impact us as individuals? How does that impact us at the family level? So we're starting big and we're kind of working our way back down. And should we allow the markets to grow? Carl Pilates said, to allow the market mechanism to be the sole director of the fate of human beings and their natural environment would result in the demolition of society. So, as we begin to consider this idea of sociology of work, I want you to begin to realize how important work and the structure of work is for the human beings on this planet. It determines whether we eat, it determines whether we have health care, it determines whether we're integrated with other people around the planet. And so to just do a little class wrap-up, remember, I'm going to see you next Saturday. Bye-bye. I'm going to go to the hospital.